What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous videos of this series, we started off by implementing your classic binary search tree. Then in the AVL and Red Black Trees videos, we enhanced this implementation to become a self-balancing tree. Today we are going to combine the properties of a binary search tree and the rotations used to self-balance a tree into a new implementation of binary search trees called splay trees. A splay tree is an efficient implementation of a balanced binary search tree that takes advantage of the location of the nodes inside a tree. This location allows a very fast lookup of the nodes that have been accessed several times by the user. Splay trees are typically used in the implementation of caches, memory allocators, garbage collectors, data compression algorithms, and many more. But how do we know, inside a tree, that this set of elements, or this element in particular, is to be accessed more frequently? And most importantly, when we have this information, how do we make sure that this element will be easier and faster to access in future lookups? Well, the easiest and fastest element we can retrieve in any tree is the root node. So what splay trees do is when the user accesses or tries to retrieve an element from the tree, the nodes of this tree will be splayed in a way to place this element at the root position. Therefore, when and if the user retrieves this item a second and third time, it will be returned to him instantaneously, as now it is the root of our tree. All the properties of a binary search tree that are preserved as splay trees are themselves binary search trees. However, in case of splay trees, we do not care if the tree is balanced or not. What we do care about is that the item that was last retrieved by the user is located at the root. So, we may have this as a splay tree, and that could be totally fine, as long as the element 20 and its closest children and descendants are the ones that are the most accessed by the user using this tree. Now, to bring the accessed element to the top of the tree, we do what we call splaying. And while splaying, we may encounter several use cases or situations, just like the ones we encountered with AVL trees and red-black trees. The first situation we may encounter and are going to talk about goes by the zig situation. Remember, our ultimate goal is to bring a certain node to the root spot or to the top of our tree. So if the node we want to place at the root is one of the root's children, then we have to apply a left or a right rotation on the root based on if the node in question is the right or left child, respectively. Take this tree as an example, and suppose that element 15 is the element we want to move to the root position, as it is the element the user accesses the most. To do that, we have to apply a left rotation on node 10, and voila, node 15 is now the root of the tree. Similarly to this previous case, and symmetrically to the tree, if the splaying was to be done for node 8, then a right rotation would be required on node 10. Now, the second situation we are going to cover also has two subcases symmetrical to the tree. This situation is known as the zig-zig situation, and you may recall its cases from our previous videos as the right-heavy and left-heavy situations. You see, the thing is, in splay trees we don't actually care if the nodes are clustered to the left or to the right side of the tree or subtree. We are not trying to balance that tree. All we care about is that the selected node is placed at the root, and that is why these cases are grouped under the same situation. So, in case the node we want is located heavily to the left, then we will need two right rotations on its grandparent first, then on its parent, to bring it to the top of the tree or subtree we are dealing with. Like in this example, to bring node 4 to the top, we had to execute a right rotation on element 10 first, followed by another right rotation on 8. Consequently, if the node we want was heavily located to the right, then we will need first a left rotation on its grandparent, then another left rotation on its parent. In the example you see in front of you, we had to apply a left rotation on node 10, followed by another left rotation on node 15 in order to bring node 20 to the top. The last situation we need to take into consideration goes by the zigzag situation. And you may have already guessed that under this situation fall two cases we also previously covered. You may recognize these cases as the left-right and right-left situations. Take this tree, or subtree, as a representation for the left-right case. In order to bring node 8 to the top, we have to apply a left rotation on node 4, which is its parent node, followed by a right rotation on node 10, which was its grandparent node before this last rotation, and now it is its parent. Symmetrically to this case, we have the right-left situation where we need to apply a right rotation on the parent of the node we are trying to bring to the top, in this example node 15, followed by a left rotation on the new parent of this node or its old grandparent, in our case node 10. So, as a quick recap, the cases we just went through should be checked for every time the user tries to look for a node inside the tree, and the corresponding rotations should be applied after every search, making future find operations done by the same user return with a faster result. Now let's go ahead and try to implement the Splay Tree class together. Let's start with the Node class. This class will store the data needed, in addition to references to the left child, right child, and to the parent of the node. If you have watched our previous videos, you will notice that the Splay Tree Node class mostly resembles the red black tree one, minus the color attribute, of course. And because of that, the insert, delete, and rotation operations we are going to implement during this video will have similar implementations to the ones we did in our red black trees video. Also, and as we previously did, we generified this class to be able to store all kinds of objects inside our tree. We also annotated the node class and a couple fields with Lombok annotations. These annotations will allow us to get rid of all the boilerplate code in our class. Now you can call this a class and be done with it. However, what I did is added a few extra methods that will turn out to be very helpful when implementing the splaying logic of our splay tree. The first one will return the grandparent of the node invoking this method, and the other two will return true or false based on if the node calling them is a left or right node. Now let's take a look at the tree interface implemented by the splay tree class. As you can see, this interface is very similar to the one we've been using in our previous videos and in our various binary search tree implementations. Therefore, and because splay trees are themselves binary search trees, checking whether the tree is empty or not, retrieving the maximum or minimum element from the tree, and traversing the tree all have similar implementations to what was previously covered for classic binary search trees. Additionally, because the node class is very similar to the one we created in red black trees video, the implementation of the insert and delete operations is also kind of similar to the red black trees one. The only thing we need to change is remove the call to the recolor and rotate method. In the red black trees video, we only adapted the insert operation to work on nodes having a parent reference. So what we are going to do now is adapt the delete operation as well to work for the node we have. Before doing this, let's take a look at the splay tree class where all these methods will sit. As you can see, we only need a reference to our root node. And also notice how we generalized this class and made it implement the tree interface we just saw. Okay, concerning the delete operation, I am going to start by retrieving the implementation we did in our binary search trees video, and then we are going to try and adapt this implementation to work on splay trees. The code you see is actually what we previously implemented. This covers the three delete use cases we discussed, if you remember. The first one being deleting a leaf node, the second one deleting a node having a single child, and the third one deleting a node having two children. To adapt this code to splay trees, what we need to do is take into consideration the new field added to their node class, which is the parent node reference. So, every time we update a child node, we also have to update the parent reference to make it point to the correct node. However, because while deleting we may return with null nodes, then this line we added might deal with nulls. And because we want to avoid null pointer exceptions, then before updating the parent, we have to check if the node we are dealing with is a null node or not. And only if it isn't, we proceed by updating its parent. Now on to the main functionality provided by splay trees, which is searching for a node inside a tree. So, to find a specific element inside the tree, we need to start our search right from the root node. That is why, actually, if the element we access the most or want to retrieve is at the root, then our find method would kind of be over after this one line we just added. Now, what we need to do is traverse our tree in search for our element. This can be done using a while loop and the iterator variable we just created. And while this variable isn't a null node, to traverse the tree, we have to check if the statement we are looking for is smaller than our iterator variable. If it is, then during the next iteration, this variable should point to its left child. And if it is bigger, then during the next iteration, it should point to its right child. So while looping over the elements of our tree, if we manage to find the element we are looking for, then we have to splay this tree, or rearrange the nodes of the tree in a way that places the node we found at the root position. This was done using the splay method. Inside the splay method, we are going to cover the six cases grouped into the three situations we discussed at the beginning of the video. Finally, after splaying the tree, we return with the node we found. However, if the while loop exits without finding the element we want, then we return with the null value. Okay, now before implementing the splay method, I want to mention that there is indeed a way to implement the find method recursively. All you need to do is replace the while loop with an if statement and move this whole logic to another method, the recursive method. Then, after identifying the next node we are going to hop to in our tree traversal, this node is passed to the recursive method, allowing us to replicate the same behavior of the while loop. Now, concerning the splay method, what we need to do is check for the three situations we had and apply rotations until the node passed to the method becomes the root node. This behavior is represented by the while loop you see in front of you. The first situation, or the zig situation, is identified by checking if the grandparent of the node passed to the method is a null node, because if it is, then the node we are dealing with must be the left or right child of the root. So, if it is the left child of the root, then we have to apply a right rotation on the root, which is the parent of this node, making our node the root node. However, if it is the right child of the root, then a left rotation is required in order to place this node at the root position. Now, if the grandparent isn't null, and both the node we are searching for and its parent are left children, then we will find ourselves in the zig-zig situation, and in particular, the left-heavy case. To bring our node to the top, we have to apply a right rotation on the grandparent, followed by another right rotation on the parent node. The symmetric case, known as the right-heavy case, will be encountered when both the node in question and its parent are right children, and symmetrically, this is resolved using a left rotation on the grandparent, followed by another left rotation on the parent node. The last situation we covered, consisting also of two cases, is the zigzag situation. The cases of this situation are encountered when the node we searched for is a left child and its parent is a right child, or when the node is a right child and its parent a left child. These cases are respectively resolved by applying a right rotation on the parent of the node, followed by a left rotation on its new parent, or by applying a left rotation on the parent of the node, followed by a right rotation on its new parent. Now, concerning the rotate left and rotate right methods, their implementations are actually exactly the same as the ones we covered in the red-black trees video. So if you want to dive in the details of their implementations, I recommend you check the video linked in the description down below. With this, the implementation of the splay tree class is now complete. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.